spot to you because we have a visitor today, little Tyler Ross, who's helping Dennis ring the bells this morning. I was a little bit this morning, we're celebrating the third Sunday of Easter, both in person
holy and righteous God, you are the author of life, and you adopt us to be your children. Fill us with your words of life, that we may live as witnesses to the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. A reading from Acts. Peter addressed the people. You Israelites, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us as though by our own power or piety we have made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our ancestors, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and rejected in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him. But you rejected the Holy and Righteous One and asked to have a murderer given to you. And you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses. And by faith in his name itself has made this man strong, whom you see and know. And the faith that is through Jesus has given him this perfect health in the presence of all of you. And now, friends, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. In this way, God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, that his Messiah would suffer. Repent, therefore, and turn to God, so that your sins may be wiped out. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We will read Psalm 4 responsibly. I'll read the odd verses, and you may follow with the even verses. Answer me when I call, O God, defender of my cause. You set me free when I was in distress. Have mercy on me and hear my prayer.
You mortals, how long will you dishonor my glory? How long will you love delusions and deceit after lies?
Know that the Lord does wonders for the faithful. The Lord will hear me when I call.
Tremble then, and do not sin. Speak to your hearts in silence upon your bed.
Offer the appointed sacrifices and put your trust in the Lord.
Many are saved. Who will show us any good?
Let the light of your face shine upon us, O Lord. You have put gladness in my heart, more than when grain and wine abound.
In peace, Lord, I can sleep, for you alone, O Lord, make me rest secure.
A reading from 1 John. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he was revealed to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him sins. No one who sins has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Himself stood among the disciples and said to them, "Peace
be with you. They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened, and why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I, myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy, they were disbelieving and still wondering. He said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, from beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of all these things." This, my brothers and sisters, is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. No one believes the good news of Jesus' resurrection. No one. Not even Jesus' own disciples, who had been close to him. Such doubt actually starts with them. Luke tells us that the disciples dismissed the testimony of the women who'd been at the empty tomb as an idle tale, thinking that they had lost their minds, even after Peter ran to the tomb and confirmed that it was indeed empty, even after two disciples returned to share their encounter with the risen Christ on the road to Emmaus. The others still aren't convinced. Today, Jesus appears in their locked room and finds that while in their joy, they were still disbelieving, still wondering. Jesus himself may have wondered, what else could he do to prove to them that he wasn't some ghost or spirit, that it was indeed him, their teacher, their friend, their Lord, in the flesh, wounds and all. So while they're staring in amazement and fear, Jesus says something rather unexpected. "You got anything to eat?" Something that I would often hear from my grandchildren. Food, you see, makes all the difference. Sharing a common table once meant the safety of everyone at the table, building trust among those who shared in the same food, creating a temporary sense of peace. On this day, Jesus asks the stunned group to share their food with him, offering peace in his presence, calming their fears and opening their minds, not just with his words, but through the very act of sharing a meal. Even today, when all that's happening around us threatens to overwhelm, and we find ourselves filled with doubts, whether to get a vaccine, whether to travel out of the house, whether children should attend school in person, when we're filled with the stress of a long isolation, missing our family and friends, suffering through the loss of a loved one, or stressing out over our inability to return to anything that seems normal. When we simply don't have the words to express the anger, confusion, sadness or fears in our hearts, there does seem to be one constant that makes life just a little bit better. Food. There's simply nothing like mom's homemade mac and cheese, or meatloaf and mashed potatoes, a bowl of homemade chicken noodle soup, or for me, Ed's turkey chili. How about freshly baked bread coming just out of the oven? It can reduce our anxiety and provide some measure of comfort. Of course, this comfort is a temporary fix, but it is also a tasty one, especially during a prolonged pandemic. Even if we might think that we see the light at the end of our isolation tunnel, we still hunger for comforting, companionship, freedom, and faith. The traditional foods of our childhood that seem to fill both our bellies and our hearts. Perhaps that's why us Lutherans are so well known for our cover dishes and potlucks. With everything spread out like a calorie-laden, crazy quilt of love. American journalist and social activist Dorothy Day once said, "Food for the body is not enough. There must also be food for the soul." When we lack words, we bring food. When we want to offer comfort and care, it often comes in the form of casseroles, cookies, or brownies, all baked with the spirit of love and hope. Perhaps this is what makes Jesus' post-resurrection appearances so appealing. Wherever food is shared, you'll find God. Jesus breaks bread after walking with the disciples on the Emmaus Road. He shares a fish barbecue with his disciples on the shore. Jesus offers fuel for our bodies as well as our souls. And our hunger is satisfied in the presence of the risen one. "Peace be with you," was Jesus' greeting to a room filled with frightened disciples. "What do you got to eat?" was Jesus' surprising yet ordinary question that showed them he was truly present. Then by eating the fish that they shared with him, Jesus provides them with some comfort and peace of mind. Using this food for thought, Jesus opens their mind to understand all that he's taught them. No one had believed, yet Jesus didn't condemn them for doubting. He simply met them where they were. He provided what they needed, not just once, but several times. Jesus continues to come to meet us, to seek us, and always provides for us wherever we are, on the beach, in an upper room, in our home, a hospital bed, a firehouse, or a classroom, attending a Zoom meeting, or watching on Facebook Live, worshiping online or in person. We receive Jesus' message of peace. And when we're able, we share his meal of bread and wine, comfort food for the body, and spiritual food for the soul. Still, it's not so surprising that we do have doubts from time to time. Really, doubt just seems to be a part of that whole faith process. Perhaps, like doubting Thomas, we want to see for ourselves. Though, in the light of all the death and trauma, disappointment and tragedy that impacts every human life these days, if we're having even a little bit of difficulty believing that God raised Jesus from the dead, promises new life and second chances, forgiveness and grace for us all? Well, we're in good company. Those disciples who knew Jesus in the flesh were the first to doubt him. As they hid in fear and disbelief. Through those words and actions of the risen Christ, however, those doubtful disciples were empowered and equipped for ministry and mission on a Galilean beach in an upper room and as he broke bread. We know through scripture and tradition that those early disciples went on to share their faith story along with Jesus' word and meal. They carried his legacy far and wide, boldly, and sometimes at great cost. Today, we are recipients of that same faith, of that same meal, and the spirit-filled results of those early meals shared with Jesus. So, we shouldn't be too surprised to learn that we're also empowered and equipped for ministry and mission. We gather in person and online to hear scripture read and the word of God proclaimed in ways that help to ease our doubts and our fears, encouraging us all to live out our faith each and every day. We gather around Christ's table for bread and wine or grape juice, for health food, food for thought, and comfort food. Food that has no need of being supersized to satisfy our hungry hearts. Jesus is always our host at this meal, offering spiritual health food to strengthen our souls and feed our faith. Offering food for thought to open our minds and hearts to a deeper understanding. Offering comfort food that is low in fat and cholesterol, but high in grace and mercy. Jesus extends his invitation to all people. Come as you are. Come with a deep faith. Come with a faith that is deeply challenged. Come hungry. Come helpless. Come hesitant. Come hopeful. Eat and live, and then go and tell. Today, we are the witnesses. Whether we're afraid, doubtful, bold, or faithful, let us bear witness to the risen Christ, who is always at work in the world. Let us recognize in his very presence, in our very midst, as we break bread, drink wine, and praise God together. As we gather, becoming the body of Christ, fed and empowered to share our own faith stories through word and deed, each day of our own very ordinary lives. Come and be fed. There is always enough room and plenty of Jesus for us all. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
present are encouraged to offer a sign of peace from where they are standing, such as a nod, a bow, a hand over your heart, a peace sign, a wave. Those watching, as well as all of us here, are urged to reach out to others in whatever way we're able. Check in with each other as a sign of God's love and God's peace for us all.
Alive in the risen Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit, we bring our prayers before God, who promises to hear us and answer in steadfast love. After the words, "Hear us, O God," you may respond, "Your mercy is great." Living God, in the midst of Easter joy, we are still filled with questions and wondering. Open our hearts and minds as we encounter the scriptures so that the church embodies repentance and forgiveness in the name of Jesus to all nations. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Creating God, like a master artist, you have fashioned the universe out of your love and delight. Heal your creation where it is in need of restoration. Provide all the inhabitants of earth a peaceful and sustainable home. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of all, the nations hunger and thirst for your righteousness. Many call on you for guidance and strength. Answer their hopes with the peace of Christ and give your loving kindness to national, state, and local leaders of people. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Healing God, you hear the cries of those in need and answer them in their distress. Grant to those who are sick and suffering your compassion and nurse them back to health and wholeness, especially those on our prayer list and those we offer now.
Those who are abused in their homes and in their communities, our veterans and their families, and those who served in the armed forces and their families.
Be close to the hearts of the lonely. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Loving parent, you have given us such love that we should be called the children of God. Reveal yourself to us so that we in this community of faith will become more and more like you in our mutual love and bold witness. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of all times and ages, those who have died in you now see that you, as you are. We thank you for their lives among us. Assure us of the peace you have promised, that we may join them in everlasting life. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
In the hope of new life in Christ, we raise our prayers to you, trusting in your never-ending goodness and mercy. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
God works in us and through us, using all that we give to support our ministries, including the care of those in need. If you're having a difficult time, please let Pastor Deb know. If you have a stable income and can give even a little more, we are deeply grateful. Let's be a blessing for others as Christ has been a blessing for us all. Let us pray. Faithful God, you walk beside us in desert places, and you meet us in our hunger with bread from heaven. Accompany us in this meal, that we may pass over from death to life with Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
You may be seated.
Joyful voice, I will sing to the Lord a new song.
It is the table of communion with the earth, in which Christ became incarnate, flesh and blood.
Amen.
God of steadfast love, at this table you gather your people into one body for the sake of the world. Send us in the power of your Spirit, that our lives bear witness to the love that has made us new. In Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
As I said at the beginning of the service, of course, this is live on Facebook, and the video will be immediately uploaded to our Facebook page at St. Paul's. But it will also be saved and uploaded to our YouTube page, which you can access from our website. So I invite you to invite your friends, perhaps, or anyone that may not have been able to be here in person or watch live. Or if you just liked it so much, you want to watch it again. That could happen, right? That could happen. Also, if you or someone you know could benefit from pastoral care or contact, I will begin doing visitations in person for some folks starting next week. If there's anyone you know that needs a visit or at least a phone call, please let me know in the office. Are there any other announcements that anyone needs to make? Don raised his hand way up there.
Hello. The rummage sale is quickly approaching us. We are taking items starting the 3rd of May, 3rd, 4th, and 5th drop off here. The 6th is our setup day, and the 7th and 8th are the actual rummage day sales. If you have any items, you can bring them in on the drop-off days. If you need them picked up, please contact me, and I will get them picked up. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. I know that we are going to be having a music and worship team meeting soon. I know Enid is working on a date for that to get everybody going with that, because in May we have two things that are kind of big. Well, of course, there's Pentecost, which is big, you know, the Holy Spirit and all of that. But on May 15th, that's a Saturday, we are going to have a very special service here of installation. So it has been almost 1 year. It's like a week and a half shy of 1 year since I've been here kind of officially serving you. And we haven't done the installation yet, so this will be a happy and joyous occasion for the congregation and for me too. Kind of an affirmation that, you know, we have this relationship here, and it is a good thing, and it is blessed by God. So, you know, mark your calendar maybe for May 15th. We'll be doing a lot of planning. I know Mary's going crazy over what music to play already. And it proves to be a good time. I'm not too sure about the coffee hour stuff afterwards because, you know, the whole COVID thing and everything, although Sue is wanting to plan something for that. So we'll see what happens. Also, if you are interested in serving as an assistant, doing readings and the prayers, even if you haven't done it before, please give a call to the office, and John will get you on the schedule. And if you need some help and some training, I would be happy to do that myself. I want to just say there's not an age limit. You don't have to be at least 18. If you've gone through confirmation class, I would entertain that. If you're a really good reader, I would entertain that no matter your age. So we can get together and talk about it if you're interested. I am always in favor of involving everybody in worship as much as possible. Okay, and we don't have any other announcements? No, but we do have a very nice sending hymn, and I know that Mary is just like right there waiting to start. So I don't see the blessing on here. Was there a blessing on that? Is it missing? Is it up there? It is. Okay, so you have a sitting hand, but there's not a blessing? It's after? Oh, it is after. You know, that's what happens when you do worship at two different churches and you do it all different. So, well, let's sing.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah.